Can I track her?
All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. I want to have Mayor Grover Robinson to welcome, and then Commissioner Robert Bender. See if you want to. Thank you so much, Travis. Thank you for
being here today. We want to welcome you to the Bayview Center, which is obviously a big part of the city of Pensacola, part of what's on Bayou Texar, making sure you have access and opportunity to see your bayou. Now we want to be focused a lot on the creek and other things so you can use your bayou, and we know it's going to be clean. I see a lot of people in the audience, a lot of people both in Escambia County and the city of Pensacola who've worked a considerable amount of time to see this come here. I know COVID, a variety of other things, but listen, it's taken us about 12 years on this journey, but we're finally here, and it's good to be here. Very excited about that. I did at least want to say, I wanted to give an acknowledgement. I get to give the welcome for about 7 more days, but I did see DC earlier. He gets to give the welcomes, all the welcomes after that, but DC, so he gets to give the welcomes after that. I will recognize, since she is the city council member, is Councilwoman Sherry Myers, and I appreciate her passion for Carpenter Street. I saw her in the back. And I also saw the newly elected council member for District 2, Charles Baer. So yes, he's going to get neck problems already. You're not a city employee yet, so no workers' comp yet for that neck complaint. But anyways, this is obviously a lot of time and energy has gone into this. Very excited about this. I certainly chose the project. But I did want to welcome up here the man who made it reality and working to get it all done and bring it forward, certainly Commissioner Robert Bender, and very much appreciate him, all the work he's done to get the project to where we are actually going to see some things. And I understand from Matt, I don't know who's telling it, but I hear there's some good news, so I'm looking forward to hearing the good news as well. But I'll turn it over to Robert. Thank you for your leadership on this in the county. We appreciate you seeing this through to this point. Thank you so much, Robert.
Thank you, Mayor. But I would not have been able to be as involved, I don't think we would be as far as we are without your leadership as Pensacola Mayor and as County Commissioner. So thank you, Grover. I appreciate it. Welcome everybody. Good to see everybody again. It's great that we have, I think probably next time we need to turn the room and give it a long way. But it is great to see all these people out, all of you out tonight, because we all know how important Bayou Texar, Carpenter Creek is for this area. So I appreciate you coming out to learn more. And the mayor is right. We do have, of course, this process has taken a while. Grover, I think it was 3 years ago that we were at Washington High School. Of course, we had COVID and a couple other things, and so as we've been putting this plan together, we have also been working towards moving those plans forward, and not to steal anyone's thunder for later, but we do have some good news on some of these projects that are being funded. They're not fully awarded yet. They're still in the comment period, so we'll be sure to encourage you to go on and give positive comments that we can continue to move those forward. And so it's great that the work that has already been done is starting to pull in some of the resources around the state to get them going. And so, we're not, I would say we're not slowing down. This isn't going to sit on the shelf. We're putting the plan into action right now. So with that being said, I believe I'll turn it over to Sherry.
I'm Chrissy Maley. I'm with WSP, probably knew us formerly as Wood. We've changed company names, but we're the same people. And I'm going to say, what a great crowd. I see some familiar faces. I see some new faces. And as a consultant working on one of these watershed plans, you have no idea how important it is that the stakeholders and the community participate. I, believe it or not, was at one meeting one time when I won't name the county, won't shame them, but the only person who attended was a reporter. The only person, if you can believe that. So what a great turnout. Okay. So thank you all for coming. and thank you for such support from the leadership of the communities. Okay, so our project team, hopefully you all know them by now, but Escambia County has led the team and contracted, so Terry Berry's our project manager. Brent Whip has been with us throughout. Actually, I didn't see the city staff here, but I probably just missed them. Mark Jackson and Dave Forte are with the city. Matt Posner is now with the estuary program, and all have been involved since the very beginning of the project, which has been fantastic. So, as I said, I'm Chrissy Maley. I'm the project manager for WSP, formerly Wood. Jeanette Kelson is our local boots on the ground person here in Pensacola. John Kiefer is our stream restoration expert. And Celeste Lyon is our water quality expert. Happy to have SCAPE and Wetland Sciences and Impact Campaigns on our team. Gina's not with us today, but Sophie and Edie are here from SCAPE. Keith Johnson's hiding over in the back over there. You'll hear from him later. And Travis Peterson has been instrumental in pulling all this together. I'm sure you've seen him running around putting everything in place. Okay, and last but not least, thank you all for participating. So we've had a lot of stakeholders involved. We couldn't get everybody's names up here, so if you don't see your name or your agency's name up there, we definitely appreciate you, but it has taken everybody to pull this plan together and make it meaningful and useful. And just to mention that, I think it's been mentioned before, but this project was funded by the Restore Act. And I won't go into all the details, but that is an important source of funding. So when we started, we had a set list of goals that we were looking at. We were looking at water quantity and quality. We were looking at protecting and enhancing wildlife habitat. We're looking at expanding access and recreational opportunities. Where's our bicyclists in the room? All right. We wanted to build more equitable and resilient communities. And we wanted to foster stewardship by connecting residents to our watershed. So we made it. It's been a long time. We started in January 2020. We had, you know, pandemic hit. We had to shift some things from in-person engagement to some online and some at-home engagement, which was interesting. Then we kind of got back out earlier this year. And so here we are. So we've done a lot of science and studies and engineering, and we've already bored you with those details on previous meetings. So with that, we came up with some recommendations. We have 15 project recommendations, which we developed a little bit further, and SCAPE will tell us about those. We had some community program engagements, things you all can do at your homes or at your office buildings, etc. And now we've just worked on compiling them all together. So we have developed a draft plan, which has all that information in it. We will be finalizing here over the next month, and it will be available online. So look for one last newsletter from us, which tells you where you can find the plan. Okay, so today we're gonna go through a few more things, and then we're gonna release you to walk around. So first we're gonna start about, SCAPE's gonna tell us about what we've heard at previous meetings.
Hello. So my name is Sophie. Thank you all so much for coming. Can you all hear me okay? Excellent. Okay, I have to be advancing the slides, I realize. Okay. Thank you. So a brief timeline. As Chrissy mentioned, we've been at this for a bit now, and we've had some hurdles along the way. We started back in 2019. And some of the engagement we've done has been virtual, some of it's been in person, some faces are more familiar, and some I'm meeting for the first time tonight. So thank you all for coming. Next slide. Here are some photos from previous engagement events. Typically, we will give a presentation just like this. At previous events, we've also had a story booth where we collected videos. You can watch some of those over there. Once we go to the open house. We've also collected feedback over models, and so that model is still alive today. You can visit it. It's taken on various forms throughout the project's life, and I think it'll live with the county after this watershed management plan wraps up. And then we've heard from you all through postcards, questionnaires, and thank you guys so much for your involvement in this as we move forward. Next slide. A little bit about what we've done online. So we had some interactive maps where folks could pin different assessments of the watershed, water quality, locations where, you know, concerning issues were taking place. We also had an ideas wall where people could post photos. And so we've learned a lot from that. And if you go to the next slide. More recently, it was a few months back now, we had an interactive map that had 15 project sites on it, and each one had a survey where you could fill out what you wanted to see there in terms of improvements to the watershed health and recreational improvements as well. And so we compiled all of that feedback that you gave us into 15 recommendations that were specific and tailored to those comments that we heard online and in person. We shared those back at the last public meeting, and then now, or actually at that meeting, we had the opportunity to vote on which of those three of the 15 could move forward with a little bit more design detail to see how these things could materialize, what they might look like on the ground, what shape they might take, what size they might be. And so we heard overwhelming support for specifically the area between Davis Highway and 12th Avenue. We heard that again and again, and so now if you go to the next slide, I'll share back a little bit of what we've been working on since we last met in May. So the catalytic projects, all that really means is just a little bit more design development to give shape to these ideas that we've heard over and over again. You can see these on the wall once we get up and walk around, but hopefully these are representing the ideas that you all have given us to work with. And so I'll walk through three zoomed in plans along this stretch of the creek that would be restored. And so the creek from Davis Highway to Airport Boulevard is incredibly important. This is where the action needs to happen first. It is critical to do restoration. Kiefer will speak more to the science of it. But here we're really looking at kind of neighborhood scale, public access. There might be a multimodal trail. Potentially, this could be the highest point of a kayak, blue way, after restoration, and there would have to be safe crossings for any continuous path in this area. You can go to the next slide. And I think this is really the heart of the creek restoration, where public access and ecological design come together to commemorate this incredibly important historic site of Aunt Jenny's swimming hole. And we might not necessarily know exactly what the pool dimensions were at the time, but we do know and continue to learn about the significance of this site as a place for people to come together, not only for baptisms for the New Hope Baptist Church, but also as a place of recreation. And so we've heard so many stories. You can go back there, and I know Angela Kyle and Aura Wills are here. Thank you. Your continued support throughout this process has been awesome, and I'm really looking forward to hearing more about what you've been learning through the oral history collection. So this is, you know, our first attempt of visualizing what public access could look like to this site. It might include a larger gathering space, some kind of, we're calling it scramble seating, to get down from the higher elevations to the lower creek bed and overlook. Maybe there could be opportunities for art and some kind of connective path that allows for folks to get to and from this area and back to downtown. Next slide. And so the last of these three zoom-in plans is the creek just north of 9th Avenue. And I think the emphasis here is really thinking about blue way connectivity. So what I've heard at previous meetings and online is that really you can get to 9th Avenue with your kayak and then you got to kind of turn around. It gets really messy in there, the water levels aren't as high, there's more vegetation. But potentially with restoration, this kayak trail could extend much further upstream. And this would be the turning point for that recreational amenity. And so with that, I will turn to Kiefer. Thank you. And thank you all so much.
Thank you, Sophie. Good evening, everybody. I see a lot of familiar faces, and it's been a pleasure to get reacquainted with some of y'all since May. And this is a really exciting part because we're going from concepts and ideas and plans documents to this next phase is turning it into reality, right? So how does that look in terms of phasing, the sequence of construction and the timing of that construction? So next slide. So we've got, I'll just kind of reorient you all to the site. We have, I'm gonna stand over here if you don't mind and talk from behind you, but you know, we basically, in terms of the major restoration of the creek, it's these red areas, right? So we have this area called Area 8, and then Area 10 is a large area, and I'll split that out a little bit, and then Area 11. So what's happening is sediment is moving through this system and variably accumulating in it and damaging it. So we have like 40 times a normal natural sediment load coming from just this area between Davis and Airport. So as you can well imagine, it would make sense to address that very high yield area before we try to do any restoration downstream that's just going to get buried by that sediment load. So you'll hear me speak about this Area 10 having three construction phases embedded within it, right? From Davis to Airport to Bayou, and from Bayou to 12th. Okay. So those are the three logical construction phases for that part of the creek. So the things that really affect the construction schedule more than anything else are a whole bunch of societal matters, funding, the capacity and capabilities of design teams, real estate agreements, permitting, and then the availability of quality contractors and materials. Right, plant materials and other materials necessary for the restoration. So these all have to be sourced, and it takes time to do that. And then there's the conditions of nature itself that affect the construction schedule. And I mentioned sediment. Where's the sediment coming from? And where are the urgent needs? You know, where erosion is really greatly affecting infrastructure or property, as well as the environment. So we want to prioritize those areas. So the scheduling scenarios that we can envision, really the bottom line is it's going to probably, to fully implement all of this, all the stream restoration that we have in this concept, it's going to take anywhere from 7 to 11 years. 7 years would be the shorter window. We would get started within, very ambitious, the first phase of construction could begin in 2 years. Right? The funding's available. It's going to take a couple of years to do all the design, the permitting, the real estate access agreements. So, and then about a year for construction. And so each of these project phases really is going to take a full calendar year to get finished. So those could be done in sequence, or it's possible to do in parallel. I mean, in theory, I think you can compress to 4 years, but I've just never really seen it happen on this kind of scope and scale that quickly. So I think these are reasonable, achievable schedules. Now, one thing that's really important, because the schedule will be distributed over some years, and I know some of you might be thinking 7 years, 11 years sounds like a long time, but this has been a problem decades in the making, right? So it takes some time to cure that. But we do have a great plan for curing it, and we can get started out with some just immediate direct benefits, right? So that phase one, project 10A, that's the area between Davis and Airport, the massively eroding area that has to be addressed first, right? Because it's urgent, and it creates problems for downstream waters. From there, then we can just progress downstream. You don't want to start with the downstream area because it would just get buried, right? So you just work your way down valley. Now, because it's spread out over some years, things can change, right? So things can change. And one thing we think is really prudent to keep an eye on is this Area 8. Area 8 right now has some erosion and has some stable areas. If it starts to go totally haywire with erosion, that would be the number two priority, right? But as long as it kind of stays status quo, it's the number four priority. So we recommend in our plan that monitoring be done on Area 8 and some other areas as part of an adaptive management strategy.
So based on what you see happening there, you might change your mind about what number two or number three or number four phase should be. But we definitely know where number one needs to be. And my preference is for number two to be what Sophie was talking about right here, where Aunt Jenny's swimming hole is, and then just continuing downstream from there. All right, so with that, who's next? Keith is next. So super exciting because we're starting to get down, you know, we're handing the baton off from ideas. Now we're seeking funding to make it reality, and we're close. Right, so let's get some stuff built. And thank you all for your support, because this is the kind of thing, it just becomes a study, you know, collects dust on the shelf without public interest and public activism, and we've got plenty of that. Great, thank you.
Hello, my name is Keith Johnson. I work for a small environmental ecological firm here based in Pensacola, Florida. I actually got my beginnings or start in the field here in Bayou Bahar, where I had the pleasure of working for Dr. Gerald Mashiri and Dr. James Morgan back when Hans Felix was the city engineer. That's when the Bayou was having problems with nutrients and fish kills, and it's come a long way since then. So happy to see this and happy to see this plan evolve. My task with this project was to help and develop monitoring and recommendations. Unfortunately, like the previous speakers, I have to depend on a little sheet here, so I apologize. These watershed management programs, you know, they really need a monitoring and evaluation guide that helps, you know, track the performance of these projects to ensure these projects are meeting the objectives of the plan. So stated briefly, we've provided a proverbial toolbox full of tools that, you know, both the city and the county may be able to use to evaluate the effectiveness of these projects. Again, as mentioned, 15 projects were identified in the plan. These projects are located throughout the watershed. They start in the headwaters, you know, and they're also located in the creek and within the bayou. You know, the concepts of these plans include, you know, increased public awareness. They include stormwater retrofits, including new stormwater management systems or improvements to existing stormwater management systems within the watershed, flood attenuation, habitat restoration, including both aquatic and terrestrial habitats, and stream restoration, just what John had mentioned, restoring pattern and profile of these impacted streams. To help evaluate the effectiveness of this project, we identified several metrics that may be used. You know, as you can imagine, each one of these projects are unique and different, and each one of them have different objectives, and therefore they're expected to affect the community in different ways. So we developed a variety of metrics that the city and the county may be able to employ to determine the effectiveness. As with anything, we expect this watershed management plan to have a long life, and therefore this plan will be adaptive. This is not the final plan. This is merely the plan to give us a start in the beginning with these 15 projects. It is assumed that as this plan progresses and as projects are developed, new metrics may be required as part of that. So the plan should be adapted. So the metrics that we've developed are but surface water quality. Many of the projects are designed to improve water quality. General sampling design will follow an above and below watershed approach, where we will sample above the effective watershed and below the effective watershed. And we'll look at, you know, parameters, field parameters such as dissolved oxygen, oxygen saturation, pH, turbidity. But we'll also look at nutrients such as total phosphorus or total nitrogen and other parameters, including like chlorophyll A, for example. But you know, the chemical analysis of water quality has its limit. It really tells you the quality of that water at the time of measurement. And water quality can vary, you know, over time. It can vary with flow, it can vary with climate conditions, it can vary with loading. So there's a number of things that can affect water quality. So in addition to water quality, we also want to look at biological parameters. Because really an effective way to assess the health of the watershed is to that these watersheds support living things is to look at those living things. And so one of the metrics that we suggested is evaluation of the macro invertebrate community. These are the bugs that live in the stream. The Florida Department of Environmental Protection has developed bioassessment tools. One of those tools is the Stream Condition Index, and it looks at the overall community structure of the benthic macroinvertebrate community. Just based on the composition of that community, we can make inferences on the health of that system. So our sampling design would include pre-implementation samples where we would sample the system prior to the implementation of the project. And then we would sample after the implementation or post-implementation of the project through a series of time to hopefully see those improvements to the benthic macroinvertebrate community. We also evaluate the plant community structure. Some of these projects will be restoring streams. They will be restoring wetland floodplain habitats or these headwater bagel forested wetland systems. And so one of the things that we would look at is we would look at the plant community structure. And again, the Florida Department of Environmental Protection has developed a forested wetland condition index. It was developed for isolated forested wetlands, but we can apply some of those metrics to these connected systems. And so therefore, we look at the response to that plant community structure, pre-implementation and post-implementation, to make sure that we are achieving the desired results of the plan. And additionally, that deals with aquatic systems, but we're also talking about enhancing some sandhill communities that are not directly adjacent to the flowing waters of the watershed, but are in the upland habitats. And so we've developed additional quantitative and qualitative methods that would allow us to assess improvements in that community structure, that upland community structure. And then the last metrics that we developed were fish. Within these stream restored components of the stream, it is anticipated that we will improve habitat. When you have denuded habitats, they generally support fish that can tolerate those types of conditions, those types of polluted conditions. I don't know if you're familiar with mosquito fish or not, but generally they will inhabit some of these very, very denuded habitats, and you won't find other sensitive species like sunfish or largemouth bass. So you only find this, you know, monoculture of like one species. So the intent of some of these projects is to increase habitat diversity, which then should support a higher diversity and species richness of some of these sensitive taxa. And so part of the metrics that we developed also are looking at the fish. And that's it for me. And I will turn it over to Terry Berry. Oh, don't let me forget. Forgot. One more metric on the last slide. John had mentioned it before. There will also be some geomorphic stream monitoring that will be involved. You know, once these streams are restored, the whole team recommended the placement of bank pins, which are merely just rebar that are placed in the sides of the stream channel in high stress areas. And you can look at how those change. The pins won't change, but the banks will. And so you can evaluate whether or not there's additional stresses on the stream channel. The scour chains, those are placed in the bed of the stream. Those are just long chains. And so obviously if chains become buried, then we know there's additional loading in the stream. But if the chains then become exposed and lay flat, then we know that we're losing profile. And then cross-sectional surveys, so actually surveying cross-sections of the stream and just monitoring the physical changes of the stream. That's the final metric. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Keith.
Like I said, my name is Terry Berry, and I'm like Keith. I had to have notes, and I don't know what his problem, his excuse is, but mine is I'm old, so that's why I have mine. But anyway, I'm the Restored Division Manager with Escambia County, and it's really hard to believe that we're here at the end of this project. And in just in a matter of weeks, we're going to have that final watershed management plan in our hands. It's been a long time, and we're excited to have it. But it's also sad. The Wood team has been awesome to work with, so I'm not going to miss our bi-weekly meetings that we have with them, you know, and who am I going to talk to, but they've been really great to work with, and so I'm going to be sad to see them leave, so I appreciate that. Tonight, I wanted to answer the question, where do we go from here? Okay, we've got the plan, that's everybody, everyone's thinking, we got the plan, now what? What are we going to do, where are we going to go, how are we going to do anything else? Well, the county's plan is to use this watershed management plan as a roadmap to seek other grants to fund those identified projects. There's 15 projects on there. We're looking to see how we can get grant funds to help get those started. And the Restore team has already submitted project ideas for the Restore Council funded portions list, so we've already done that. We've received two NERDA grants that I'm going to go into a little bit more detail, and we're continuing to look at grant opportunities. So we've already started getting the ball rolling, even with their draft plan. And so the first project I want to talk about that we've done is this Olive Road Headwaters. This is Site 16. We already have two NERDA grants for this. We've already bought the property. Property acquisition's been bought. We've already negotiated with our consultant to bring on board, and we've got a recommendation going to the board to give that award out on December 6th or December 8th. We're hoping to kickstart that one in January. So that would be our first project that we'd actually start with doing design and construction, survey, and all of that. And that's at the Carpenter Creek Headwaters. So that's very exciting to get that project started. Madison O'Toole, sitting over there at the table.
Yes.
Yay. She is the project manager for that project, so you can go to her. She's got information on the table. She'll be leading that activity up, and so she's excited to get that one started as well. And that's also a companion project with the Olive Road project that's going on, so she's working closely with that team also, and we will actually be scheduling weekly meetings or bi-weekly meetings with that team to make sure everything runs smoothly between those two projects. On the next slide, this is the concept that Wood put together for this slide. Our consultant would actually go and review this concept. They'll say, yes, this will work, no, we want to modify it, whatever it is, but this will be the starting point that they will use, and then we'll move forward with that. We won't know exactly what the actual concept is going to be until that consultant firm comes on board and does some survey and do some stuff. But probably usually in a couple months, 3 months after they get started, we'll have that concept nailed down. And so that is exciting to see. The county has also, on this project, and I think Brent actually applied for that, applied for another grant through the FDP Resiliency Florida program. And if that is awarded, we're actually going to get funds will help with the drainage and the roadway along Olive Road. It's going to help enhance our water quality and provide recreational opportunities. At our table is Ryan Kirby. He is with Escambia County, our Resiliency Program Manager. He's also looking at grants for us to help us move some of these projects forward. So you can go talk to him and find out what his plans are, and that would be great. And we're expecting to hear about all these grant opportunities and stuff sometime in 2023, early 2023. So the next project we have, thank you, is the Olive Road, the Outfall Project. This one, I'm excited to say that we have put in funding, a grant for this, and we have received notice that we probably will be awarded this grant. So this is a job that we'll be doing with the city of Pensacola. It is going to be, it's $5.9 million that we're going to get for design, permitting, and construction of 5 treatment units along Bayou Texar. So we're very excited to have that one. So that's two projects that we have right off the bat that are going. As soon as we get that money in, we will start doing the solicitation to try to get a contract from our board and move that forward. Terry Malone at the table. She is going to be our Escambia County point of contact with that. We'll be working with the city on that particular project. So very excited. On the next page we have, this is the concept. We have maps over there to show on the table of what it's going to look like. And as we get our consultant on board and get the funding, we'll be able to identify that a little bit more and get into more detail what exactly what it's going to look like. But those are the two projects we have right now going. And our next slide is in closing. So the county is going to continue to work with the city of Pensacola. We're going to be working with the estuary program. You'll hear Matt here just shortly to look for grant opportunities. We'll look at ways we can do partnerships to try to get these projects moving. And so on the Carpenter Creek Headwater project, as I said, we're hoping to issue that notice to proceed in January. We can get that one going and we'll have a time frame for that once it gets. And then all that information on this project and our future projects is going to be on the Escambia County website, on our myescambia.com. If you go look up projects, you'll be able to see what we're doing on each of those projects to keep abreast. We have business cards and different things on our table over there. Please call us if you've got any questions or wondering what's going on. We'll be glad to help and give you information. And that's all I have. So.
Well, hey, good evening, everybody. My name is Matt Posner. I got to know many of you over 3 years ago when this project first started, when I was directly with Escambia County, and now I'm fortunate enough to be with the Pensacola and Prudhoe Bay's estuary program. Actually, before this project even started, I remember sitting in many of Councilman Meyer's town halls at Ashbury Place back in 2018 and 2019, and it's so great to see where we are today. I wanted to touch a little bit on something that Terry mentioned, and that's this plan can't be implemented alone. It really does take a partnership of not only the city, the county, the estuary program, other groups working together, but you all as the citizens and residents and visitors that live in the Carpenter Creek and Bayou Texar area. So I'm going to take just about a minute to talk about the estuary program quickly. If you go to the next slide. So about the time the Carpenter Creek and Bayou Texar Management Plan was underway, there was a parallel effort going to establish the Pensacola and Prudhoe Bay's estuary program. This has been a real legacy effort that many of our community leaders came together after the oil spill to say, hey, what can we do that will leave a lasting legacy for this region? And that was to make sure that we're all coordinating, bringing those efforts together. And I give much credit to former Commissioner Robinson, now Mayor Robinson, for helping spearhead that effort all the way back in 2010.
Former Mayor Robinson.
All right, not until next week. And so over that 10-year period, there was a lot of momentum put behind establishing the estuary program. And for our region, we were fortunate enough to have a group known as the Bayou Resource Council, the BARC, that was around for nearly 30 years. And that group came back together and wrote a proposal to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency to transition into the estuary program. So we made that official in 2018. We serve as a non-regulatory, stakeholder-driven program that really works at that watershed scale. We stretch between Baldwin County in the west and Okaloosa County in the east and everywhere in between. And what we've been charged with doing is developing a watershed management plan on steroids, which is what I'm holding here. This is our Comprehensive Conservation and Management Plan, our CCMP. And much like the WMP, that serves as a roadmap for water quality improvement, habitat restoration, community resilience as a whole. So if you'll see me or Logan in the back in our open house forum, we do have a select few hand copies available, but this is also posted on our website. If you go to the next picture. This focuses on six goal areas and was just approved by our policy board within the last couple weeks. So we focus on improving community resilience, improving water quality, reducing sedimentation, and conserving and restoring habitat. And that includes both seagrass and oyster habitat, throughout the Pensacola and the Perdido Bay systems. Next slide. And so how does this relate back to this Carpenter Creek and Bayou Texar Watershed Management Plan? These two documents together really provides that roadmap, that forum to bring in an unprecedented amount of grant funding that we would otherwise not be eligible for. So much like Terry mentioned earlier on some great grant news announcement, the estuary program in partnership with the City of Pensacola and Escambia County just received word yesterday that funding for the design of the catalytic project for the restoration of Carpenter's Creek has been funded by DEP. And so that will stretch between Interstate 110 down to 12th Avenue. So. I just wanted to say that I think that's really a testament to both the leadership we have at the city and the county level and the collaboration that exists among the staff members, because that's really what it's going to take. And so we're all looking forward to working together to see that this plan is actually implemented here sooner rather than later. So with that, I thank you all, and we're looking forward to getting some great work done in 2023.
I thought we'd let you all talk for just a minute. So we're just gonna go through a couple trivia items. We don't have any giveaways unless you wanna sign up to volunteer for a grant over there to get a t-shirt, or you get a free snack in the back. So just feel free to shout out. Okay, how many catalytic projects were recommended? 15 total, three catalytic, one funded. Okay, which grant fund made the WMP possible?
Restore.
Very good. All right. How many site-specific recommendations were made? Now it's time. 15?
15.
All right. So before we close, I just want to thank you all again for coming out. It is really important that we hand this plan off to the community. And I was really excited about some things that I heard, which was this plan's not going to sit on the shelf. You can hear the community, the city, the county, the ESHRA program are already actively engaged in the projects. They already have funding. They're going to move this forward. So we need the entire community to move this forward. So your support has been appreciated. It's still going to be needed. It's still going to be needed. So we have a great open house here. We brought some folks together. So if you have questions about what you can do on your own property, these are the people who can make some recommendations. These are the people who can tell you what kind of permits you're gonna need. These are the people who, you know, can just bounce some ideas off you. So it is really important that you talk with everybody here, you kind of think about some ideas that you can do or your neighbor can do, and just really work together to improve this watershed, because that's what it's all about. So it has been a pleasure getting to know you all, and I'll hand it off to you now. Thank you.